Cara, if you will introduce our presenter.
Hi, I'm really excited that McKenna is going to do this presentation. I remember when I first met her, she was in the audience and she was making some really important point. And I just walked over to her and I said, would you do a talk for us? And I actually don't know that very much about her, but I will introduce her anyway and say that I know, for example, that she went dancing one time because I saw her there. And I know she studies political science. And I know she's wanting to go to law school. And I know she just recently got a job.
Yep.
So, and she's going to... So, I'm really pleased that she's going to speak with us today. Welcome her.
Hi. I'm really tall, so I apologize in advance. Okay. Well, I would just like to start by saying thank you so much for the opportunity to speak today. I was going through some old journals of mine last night in preparation for this, and as embarrassing as my 9-year-old self was, she was pretty precocious and weirdly aware of herself and her culture. But never in my wildest dreams, when I was writing about my love for and resentment of the mountains, and the deep longing within me to be able to express the spirituality that goes along with those mountains, did I ever think that I would be here, expressing something that the rest of the world considers long dead, and that anyone would care enough to sit and listen to what are summed up today as old folk tales. That's an interesting word, folk, especially hill folk. The dictionary defines it as relating to the traditional art or culture of a community. I think it's safe to say that Appalachia as a whole has been widely misrepresented, sometimes overrepresented, such as poverty-ridden images being taken by outsiders and then distributed to their benefit. But especially Kentucky. Music, for example, has been a part of Kentucky culture for a really long time. Bluegrass music was developed right here and named after the state itself. It is perhaps the best representative of this place, seeing as it speaks for itself. Interestingly, the same three distinct strands of bluegrass music are the same three distinct strands of Appalachian mysticism, Appalachian paganism, or Appalachian witchcraft, which are Native American, predominantly Cherokee, African-American, and Scots-Irish. Much of this, of course, centers around plants, which I find interesting because of the bluegrass nickname. Doctors themselves are really sparse in the mountains, and frankly, that's a problem that we see continuing into today with the lack of healthcare in certain regions. There are rarely quality hospitals, surgeons, or specialists, and perhaps that is why the herbal remedies have continued to be passed down so successfully. Illa Hatter is a well-known speaker on Appalachian wildcrafting, or the tradition in Appalachia of taking what the land offers you to heal and nurture, and then eventually turning a profit from it. She writes, "The healing traditions of Appalachia, or folk remedies, are mingled with the herbal knowledge of the Iroquois and other woodland Indians. When the first European colonists came to this unknown country, they brought familiar as plants and seeds for food and medicines, as well as the available herb books of that age, namely Gerard's Herbal and Culpepper's. This gave them a working knowledge of about 300 formulas. They soon found that their Indian neighbors, of whom the Cherokee were the most numerous tribe, were trained in 600 formulas of the native plant species. Especially bark, and interestingly enough, one of the names that they have in their tribe for their tribe is bark eater. Eventually, about 250 medicinal formulas were added to the official pharmacopoeia. Healing, then, crossed the cultural barriers as whites adopted the use of ginseng, sassafras, wild cherry bark, sumac, black walnut, dogwood bark, yellow root, and club moss. And since this is a room full of people that I know might have medical professional backgrounds, you may be interested in what doctors use for surgical gloves before rubber and plastics. They coated their hands with lycopodium powder, the spores of club moss, which is both water repellent and antiseptic. The native peoples adopted the plant immigrants, such as, I'm going to butcher this, mullein, catnip mint, not for a pet cat, but apparently it soothes colicky babies, peaches, plantain, and others. Plantain was called Englishman's foot because everywhere the white man put his foot down, the plant grew. For its ability to relieve pain and swelling, it became important snake bite poultice. Sassafras was the first export from the New World to the Old, even before tobacco. The long sea voyages caused many new arrivals to suffer from scurvy. The natives who greeted them knew about this illness and treated them with sassafras root tea. Their rapid recovery caused great rejoicing and sparked a profitable trade in the root. It was called the good news out of the New World. Though it does not cure as many ailments as once claimed, it is still a popular beverage as well in medicinal tonic in Appalachia. It is said that in the spring of the year when the blood is too thick, there is nothing so fine as a sassafras stick. It was one of the ingredients in the first iron and vitamin tonic marketed commercially, which is still available today. SSS tonic was an Indian formula patented by a South Carolina judge in 1857. I'm going to let that sit for a moment. The three S's originally stood for sassafras, spice bush, and sweet birch. Granny witching, the empresses of wildcrafting, became extraordinarily wise in this way. There are tales of all sorts of granny witches, both white settler women and women of color, working not just separately, but documented cases of them learning from one another and working together in the same communities while their menfolks were killing each other. In a time and culture, as well as a geographical location, where it was all but impossible for women to earn an income, understanding how to cure an illness or birth a baby was an invaluable trait. A family that is healed is a family that is grateful, and a family that might pass on preservatives, quilts, cooking utensils, and other supplies. This tradition is not just about plants, however, although the plant talk itself could easily take up my entire time and then probably next Sunday. These women are born out of predominantly Baptist denominations and social movements, and these women would probably take severe offense at being called witches today. Either that, or they would laugh at you. The ability to heal, the ability to birth babies, and the ability to see spirits and sense those that have passed on are seen as obviously gifts from God. Not every family member had these gifts, and it was considered a blessing to have a natural inclination toward learning these things. When I was much younger, my mother would tell my sister and I, "You two are special, and God gave you special gifts." And then we would talk about the ghosts haunting our house. Or the deceased grandfather of a girl at school whom we had no right to know about. Or the very real aspect of reincarnation. I kept a list of easy herbal remedies for stomach aches and headaches and distributed them at my lunch table to prevent trips to the school nurse. When we got warts, our grandfather would say, "Oh, that's easy. Mommy taught me how to get rid of those. Buy a potato, a good one from a garden, not from Walmart. Cut it in half. Rub one half on the wart and throw it away. Bury the other half out in the dirt. And when the buried half begins to rot, the wart will fall off." And they did every time. Some say it worked like a charm. The concepts of spirits is beautifully illustrated in artwork of Appalachia in a very specific way. Bottle trees. If you notice on the front of your programs, there's some bottle artwork. The origin of bottle trees is widely disputed. Frankly, the history of that dispute is extraordinarily racist. But it is widely accepted that the origin of bottle trees can be traced to the 9th century Congolese people in Africa. After being enslaved, they carried their traditions with them, one of which was this concept of not only placing cobalt blue bottles on trees to help usher the spirits of their deceased into the afterlife, for blue is the same color as the sky and water, and therefore can be seen as a direct channel between heaven and earth. But also to trap roaming spirits who are either evil or very lost and might invade your home. Today, we see bottle trees littering the landscape, and these same myths pervade. One of my favorite movies as a little kid was because of Winn-Dixie. And if you know anything about the book or the movie, you know that the local witch had a bottle tree. And was also African-American. And all of her bottles represented all of the bottles of alcohol she had drank battling her addiction. This perfectly illustrates something that Appalachian people still do, which is hanging up a new bottle for every problem. Making something beautiful out of something difficult, making do. There are some really interesting things that people regard as superstitions, but that have deep roots in not only biblical scriptures, but also old world paganism. And some of you might have heard of these. Death comes in threes, for example. A wild bird in the house means someone's gonna die. A dog howling three nights in a row means death is near. If you get shingles all around your body, you'll die. If you sneeze, cover your mouth and say the Lord's Prayer, or you'll lose your soul out of your mouth and die. If two women help the third one get dressed, the youngest of the three will die. Interestingly, those are all really specific to Kentucky. One of my favorite ones is that if you hang a horseshoe over your door, it's bad luck. But see, that's not necessarily true for even communities that are really close together, because my stepdad is from Danville. And when he was moving in with my mom, he had a lucky horseshoe that he wanted desperately to hang over a door. And it was one of the most amusing arguments I've ever seen my parents get into, because my mom said if he hung it up, we would die. And he said if he didn't hang it up, we would die. Yeah. The horseshoe went outside and became a garden ornament. Interestingly, not only the number three, but the color blue is repeated often in Appalachian mysticism. For example, blue haint porch ceilings, blue bottles, and blue grass. Which brings us to water diviners. Some would argue that they are the flip side of granny witches, because water diviners are traditionally only ever males. Like granny witches, not everyone born to the family has the touch. It is usually viewed as being a gift from God. The history of water divining itself is extraordinarily more well documented than any type of female-based Appalachian or otherwise spirituality or healing remedies. But I think it's very interesting because you can really clearly track it that way. And so water divining originally came out of Germany after all kinds of European wars and German immigrants moving to other European countries in the medieval ages, navigating kind of over to England, especially under Queen Elizabeth, who decided they were a lot cheaper to import German immigrants to work in her mines than to hire native ones. Does that sound familiar? The Germans had been practicing water divining for a really long time. And if you're not sure what that means, imagine a stick kind of shaped like a wishbone. And men will hold it by the two handles, and then the stick at the end supposedly either dips down or twirls in their hands whenever they happen upon water that would be good use for a well or spring. But the Germans also used it in mining. And so when they migrated over to England and started digging up all kinds of really rich ore sites, everyone was like, okay, what's the science behind this? And frankly, all the way up until today, no one knows. And it is widely disputed. A lot of the books are quite insulting. It's implied that water diviners are unintelligent or they're con artists, that sort of thing. But there were several popes that tried to excommunicate people for water divining. There were several popes that tried to hire water diviners to make more money for the Vatican. There are a lot of kings and queens that persecuted water diviners, and like Queen Elizabeth, there are a lot that hired them. And so eventually, during great migrations from Great Britain, they moved here, and that's kind of the Scots-Irish part of the three lineages of Appalachian mysticism. And so when I was really young and visiting my great-grandparents, I snuck outside because I was a girl and wasn't allowed to watch. My great-grandfather showed his water dividing rod to my uncles and my father. They seemed really interested but also really amused. I listened to them laugh and watched them try out their own touch like my grandfather. Eventually, my uncle snickered and joked only a rich city man would come to the mountains and call the ability to find water witchcraft. This embrace of witchcraft and alternative mystic practices while alternately denying any association with it is almost an inside joke in Appalachia. However, for every granny witch and water diviner that doesn't go to church but once a year and can recite most verses anyway and claim absolute penitence, there's the opposite. Growing up, I lived not 3 miles as the crow flies from a church that practiced snake handling. Now, many writers attempt to designate a man named George Hensley, who died in 1955 of a snake bite, as both the creator of this sort of religion, but also the man that popularized it. This is distinctly untrue. Snake handling goes back centuries, and honestly is weirdly tied to more Eastern religions, and so I would love to figure out how it managed to go down and around, but there's not a lot of interest in scholastic articles on that sort of thing, unfortunately. The origins of the observances are really unclear, mostly just because it started in Pentecostal congregations and then slowly worked its way to Baptists and Methodists, and then evangelicals. In the early days, worshippers were encouraged to lay hands on the sick, speak in tongues, and provide testimony of miracles. Sometimes they would also skip the snake bites altogether and just directly consume arsenic. It worked out real well for them. Snake handlers, it's important to note, do not worship snakes, right? Instead, they use the snakes to show non-Christians that God protects them from harm. In church services, when they feel the Holy Spirit come upon them, these Christians reach into boxes, pick up venomous snakes, and hold them as they pray, sing, and dance. My mom used to joke it wouldn't be half so bad if they didn't use copperheads. Gathering mainly in homes and converted buildings, snake handlers adhere to strict dress codes, such as uncut hair, ankle-length dresses for women, and no cosmetics, and short hair and long-sleeve shirts for men. Most preach against any use of tobacco or alcohol. Like their predecessors, today's snake handlers believe in a strict and literal interpretation of the Bible, believing that denominations are human-made and carry the mark of the beast. I guess no one ever pointed out to them that snake handling is in and of itself a denomination. Those who die from snake bites are never criticized, but instead it's just determined that that's when God decided they were going to go. I kind of wonder, because it's like, if you never picked up the snake, I doubt God would have decided that. But there is, you know, biblical evidence for snake handling and, you know, the practices of it. Verses 9 through 20 of Mark 16 discuss, you know, I can't remember exactly what it says. I should have wrote it down. Discusses, you know, something along the lines of, like, as I was the serpent, so you may deal directly with me. I'm paraphrasing, so don't take that very literally. But there's a case to be made for them. I can say that much at least. But evidence from the late second century for the existence of copies of Mark with that longer ending is contended by a majority of biblical scholars. The first report of a death from a serpent bite occurred in 1922 at the Church of God Evangel. In 1967, Jean Saylor, wife of a snake-handling preacher, died after being bitten by a rattlesnake in Bell County, Kentucky. In 1995, Melinda Brown from Parrotsville, Tennessee, died after being bitten by a timber rattlesnake during a service at Full Gospel Tabernacle in Jesus' Name in Middlesboro, Kentucky. In 1995, Cale Saylor, husband of Jean, died by being bitten by a rattlesnake at a church in Crockett, Kentucky. In 1997, Daryl Collins died after being bitten by a snake in Bell County, Kentucky. In 06, Linda Long, London, Kentucky. In 2014, Jamie Coots, Middlesboro, Kentucky. Coots was also featured on the TV series Snake Salvation, if anybody's interested in that. In 2015, John Brock died after being bitten in Jensen, Kentucky. Note that in October of 1942, the handling of any reptile in a religious service was deemed illegal in the state of Kentucky and can be fined up to $100, which in 1942 probably seemed like a lot more than it does now. Keep in mind, this is only skimming the surface of Appalachian folk religion, and honestly, it's only the bits that I've had contact with personally. I by no means claim that it is comprehensive. You could go on for hours about any one of these three topics. I think it's interesting to note the connections between coal and divining and religion and how deeply people cling to it. I think it's interesting to note the historical documents that state that white women and women of color worked closely together until it was either made illegal or made so socially dangerous that they couldn't anymore. I think that it's particularly interesting to note the sorts of things that are still carried on today, the sorts of superstitions, right, that still exist in the back of your head, and you're like, I have an iPhone and I can easily Google that this isn't real, but I probably shouldn't do this. I think it's really important to make sure that going forward, you know, generations such as my future children or the children of my peers don't forget these sorts of things. Because as steeped in superstition as they are, a lot of these herbal remedies, for example, will still cure things. A lot of these superstitions have a grain in truth somewhere, right? And a lot of these traditions are very intersectional and bring together a lot of different types of people. And I think that that's something we can all really learn from. So hopefully it gave y'all a peek at a spiritual world that kind of skirts the edges of your own, or maybe you grew up in it and this reminded you a little bit. Thank you so much for your time today. It's really appreciated, and I would love a discussion.